And welcome to Ask Dr. John. I'm Dr. John L. Brooks, a Christian counselor at Friendly Temple Missionary Baptist Church, located at 5515 Dr. Martin Luther King Drive in St. Louis, Missouri, and at 14700 New Halls Ferry Road in Florissant, Missouri, where the honorable, gifted, and anointed pastor is Bishop Michael Fulton Jones. He is a friend of mine, and I want you to know he is one of the true rare ministers in this country who is truly serving the community in so many ways. And so without prolonging this intro, I'm just going to start off with a word of prayer, and we'll dive right into the five most important questions we need to ask in terms of our being as the church, the body of Christ, the kingdom of God. Let's have a word of prayer. Gracious Lord, we just thank you so much for lifting us, supporting us, providing for us, protecting us. Father, as we proceed through even this adventure of understanding what church power really is, Father, we know that all power rests in your hands, and we are the beneficiaries of that power. And so, Father, guide us through this series in order that many might understand our potential as your people to make changes, to change lives, to make life even better, so much better than it is today. And so, in Jesus' name, we thank you for all your blessings. Let all God's people say, amen. Well, amen, and let's get started. Well, as you can see, we're about to get started on our development plan, and we're going to do a sample plan for you to use for your, as an example, for your own purposes, for your own congregation. And again, please get your pastor involved to allow him to see what we're all capable of as his congregation. Let's let him know how well we support him and get him involved and allow him to even lead us through this journey that we're going to do in order to awaken church power, our power to love one another as well as others. And so let's look at this. The first part of this is going to be the five most important questions we should ask about our future. Number one, who are we? What makes us different from others? Well, let's look at some examples, and we're going to spend a little bit of time on this because it's so important. Identification, again, is probably, if not the most important, it's right near the top of human existence, our identification. Who do we identify with? Who do we see ourselves in? Do we see ourselves in Christ, and do we see him in us? Oh, so important. Let's look at what we're dealing with right now. What makes us different from others? Well, here's some examples. Jesus' kingdom is not out of this world, not of this world. For it contrasts with the kingdom of the world in every possible way. This is not a simple contrast between good and evil. The contrast is rather between two fundamentally different ways of doing life. Two fundamentally different mindsets and belief systems, two fundamentally different loyalties. Here are five ways that it is different. And this is adapted from a work called Myth of a Christian Nation. And you can find this on pages 46 through 48. Let's look at these five ways that we are so different from everyone else in the world. A contrast of trust. The kingdom of the world trusts the power of the sword, the gun, the rifle. As we are seeing so much gun violence in the streets in our present day. While the kingdom of God trusts the power of the cross, the kingdom of the world advances by exercising power over, while the kingdom of God advances by exercising power under. Now, this is the one I chose, but the other ones, a contrast of aims. The kingdom of the world seeks to control behavior, while the kingdom of God seeks to transform lives from inside out. Get that straight, from inside out. Also, the kingdom of the world is rooted in preserving, if not advancing, one's self-interest and one's own will, while the kingdom of God is centered exclusively on carrying out God's will, even if this requires sacrificing one's own interests. And then there's a contrast of scopes, a contrast of responses, and a contrast of battles. Have mercy. As it says in Ephesians 6 and 12, there is a warfare the kingdom of God is involved in, but it is not against enemies of blood and flesh. It is rather against rulers, against the authorities, against cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. And you can read that for yourself. And if you want to pause this for a second, I'll take a brief break and allow you to put this on hold and do a screen print of it for your own purposes for now. All right, let's continue. As I said before, I chose the number one, the world trusts the power of the sword, while the church trusts the power of the cross. Amen. The world advances by exercising power over you. While the kingdom of God advances by exercising power under the authority of Christ Jesus, under the authority of God Almighty. Y'all can say amen. And I just want to warn you, when we start going through scripture and so forth, I have a tendency to get a little excited because I know it's the truth. And that's just what just keeps me going, just keeps me encouraged and keeps me lifted up. And so if I seem to get a little excited, I just want to warn you ahead of time, because I love the Lord. I love the word. I love to teach the word. I love to preach the word. I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I just want to make that clear. Let's move on. Where are we today and how did we get there? Have mercy. Let's look at this. This is an example of where we are today and how we got there. Because of so much religious confusion, many people have become turned off by what they call organized religion and decide to stay at home and worship God alone with their family or with a few other people. We are thinking that God's church is not adequately serving the needs of people. Let me repeat that. We are thinking, we being the ones who are really taking a close look at our impact on the world today, we are thinking that the church is not adequately serving the needs of the people. Who do we really want to be? Who do we really want to be? An example of that is, well, this is, again, this is from me, and this is just an example. I'm sure you have your own words to put in to answer these questions, but just for this demonstration, this is what I chose. We want to be the real church. Did you hear that? The real church, the body of Christ. As the Apostle Paul wrote, for the body is one and has many members, but all members of that body, being many, are one body. So also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one Spirit. 1 Corinthians 12, verses 12 and 13. Oh, I hope you receive that. We are all one. Race does not even apply in the body of Christ. We are who he made us to be. It doesn't matter what color, what ethnic background. It doesn't matter where we live. We are all considered equal in the body of Christ. And so this is the church. This is the real church. The real church. Amen. What do we really have going for ourselves? Now, it seems like this doesn't even need an answer because we can speak about that for ourselves, can't we? Let's look at this. What do we really have going for ourselves? Have mercy. Our Almighty Father God will supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory. And Christ Jesus will never leave us nor forsake us. And you'll find that in Philippians 4:19 and Hebrews 13:5. Oh, the word is powerful, brothers and sisters. And we have so much to be thankful for. We have so much going for us. There's no reason for us to fail at getting the work done. The work that God has mandated us to do. All right. And this is so important, to have vision. Where there is no vision, the people perish. I'm sure you've heard that. I'm sure you know that scripture. But what we're talking about here is vision for where we are going. Where is God leading us? Let's see. Through our steadfast and immovable faith in our Almighty Father God, we being his church, we will receive his magnificent power and strength to change lives and truly bear witness to who he is. We're talking about the real church and real church power. Yes, we are. And we're going to go further into this. This is a relatively short session, but it is a powerful session because I want you to take these and rewind it and answer these questions for yourself. Again, get your pastor involved and see where God has mandated you to do work, to do the work, to do the work that you're assigned to, that we're all assigned to. And so with that being said, let's get to work. Let's get to work getting God's work done. Well, we hope that you stayed with us through this exercise. It's so important that we understand just who we are. Identification is so important. We must all be able to identify with the church, the body of Christ, and understand that each of us has a part. Each of us has a role to make God's work, God's will be done here on earth. Through us, He has bestowed us the mandate to help as many as possible and to stand up for righteousness as He has defined in His word. So we're going to pray out and see you next time. Gracious Lord, thank you so much for taking us on this tour of what church power is all about. We thank you for empowering us and with the knowledge and equipping us with the knowledge of your word and knowing that we are special, we are different from others, just because you have put your hand on our lives. Father, we're going to thank you continually, even if we don't amount to 10,000 tongues, we're going to praise you anyway, the best we know how. And so as we leave this place today, we just want you to know that we appreciate you, we love you, and we stand by you in Jesus' name. Let all God's people say amen. Amen. And we will see you next time.